I thank IMA Kodambakkam for giving me the opportunity to talk on this subject. I am a urologist. Till last month, I was working as HOD in the Department of Urology in Pondicherry Medical College, PIMS, Pondicherry Institute of Medical Science. Now I have come back to Chennai and I am doing private practice. All of us must do our duties. Whenever we overact, then there is a problem. Judicial overactivism is seen. And now many governors are now doing more action or overacting. That is also creating a lot of problems. Sometimes bladder overacts, and it creates a very, very important problem. It gives an urgency to void. That is the main. Overactive bladder means urgency to void. Let us just see some anatomy. The innervation of bladder. It has got sympathetic and parasympathetic innervation, also to somatic innervation. But the main important two things are parasympathetic and sympathetic. Parasympathetic arises from S1, S2, S3, S4 segments and reaches the bladder in the hypogastric plexus. It is mainly for contraction of the bladder. Parasympathetic is for contraction. Sympathetic is the outflow is from T10 and L2, and it is a relaxing the bladder. Sympathetic innervation relaxes the bladder and contracts the sphincter. This is important. So the bladder sympathetic relaxes the bladder and contracts the sphincter to store the urine. Parasympathetic is for contracting the bladder. At that time, the sphincter must relax. This is the mechanism. Overall control is, of course, in the cortex. Cortex acts through two areas. One area is pre-aqueductal gray area. And next is the pontine micturition center. Usually, pontine micturition center controls the parasympathetic flow. It usually keeps it inhibited. All the time, parasympathetic thing is inhibited by the pontine micturition center. Whenever there is a filling of bladder, afferents go to the through the pre-aqueductal gray to the cortex. And the cortex, if the situation is not suitable for, there is no bathroom or anything, it sends a signal to the pontine micturition center to keep it inhibited, to keep the parasympathetic system inhibited. When a suitable area is found and the time is found, then it gives an order to the pontine micturition center to activate the parasympathetic system. At the same time, it inhibits the sympathetic system. Yeah, bladder contracts, sphincter relaxes, and the person passes urine. What is overactive bladder? It is a syndrome of sudden and compelling reason to pass urine. This is very embarrassing because at that time you may not be near a bathroom, you may be traveling. So this is a real problem for all the persons. And urinary urgency is the hallmark symptom. They may have urinary incontinence or they may not have incontinence. So if the urgency is so severe, they pass urine because they cannot control it. That is urinary incontinence, also known as urge incontinence, in contradistinction to stress incontinence. Stress incontinence is whenever the abdominal pressure is increased, you leak urine. That is called stress incontinence. Whenever you lift a weight or bend or do some coughing or something, then urine leaks, that is stress incontinence. Whereas this is urge incontinence. And frequency and nocturia are also, most often they are present. Nocturia is getting up from sleep one or more times to pass urine. Even if you get up one time, it is nocturia. The diagnosis is very, you have to exclude many things. Then you come to the idiopathic overactive bladder. Overactive bladder is just a symptom of urgency. So main commonest thing is urinary tract infection must be excluded. Other pathological conditions must be excluded. Of course, to confirm it, you should demonstrate detrusor overactivity by a urodynamic study. So that is for academic purpose. We can restrict ourselves to symptomatology and history. So the important thing is history. And next is physical examination. Urine analysis. These are important. Optional. Even urine culture is optional. Post-void vesicle urine and bladder diary. Bladder diary is the patient should maintain the time and the quantity of urine he passes. It should be at least 3 days. 3 days is the ideal time for your diary. From this you can, and also they should note down the amount of fluid they intake. Sometimes patients can take a lot of fluid that can cause nocturia and this overactive bladder. Very complicated cases only we go in for ultrasound of the kidney, ureter and bladder and cystoscopy and urodynamic study. These are not usually done. So detailed history, we should see whether the patient has urgency, intense, sudden, intense desire to pass urine. What is the duration? Has he got nocturia? Does it bother him? That is more important. Whether the symptom is bothering him very much. Medical and surgical history, especially medicines like diuretics. If the patient is taking diuretics, he will have a lot of urine production and that can initiate this overactive bladder symptoms. Gynecological and obstructive history should be taken. Whether he is taking a lot of alcohol and fluid intake. Some people take a lot of fluid just before going to bed. That also causes more secretion of urine in the night. And glaucoma. You should know whether the patient is having any narrow angle glaucoma. This is important for the treatment. Pulmonary and the cardiovascular system must be examined. This is also for any symptoms of dyspnea and other things, and any diuretics are needed. Abdomen, bladder distension should be tested. Usually, bladder distension must be checked by percussion, not by palpation, because obese individuals, you may not be able to see whether the bladder is distended or not. By percussion, you can detect the bladder distension. Pelvic examination and PVPR, especially for BPH obstruction. And my simple neurological examination to see the perineal sensation and the bulbocavernous reflex. Urine analysis, you look for hematuria. If there is hematuria, we should rule out any malignancy. Then pyuria. If there is pyuria, that means there is infection. That may be the reason for the overactive bladder. And glucosuria. So if there is a lot of glucose, again, that may be the reason. So in the overactive bladder, you exclude other things and come to the diagnosis. Post-void urine. Residual urine is measured by ultrasound in men with obstructive symptoms, especially prostate or stricture.
women who have undergone surgery, they should undergo this post-void residual urine measurement. If the measurement is more than 150 to 200 ml, it is significant. These are the treatments recommended by the American Urological Association. One is behavioral therapy, then drugs, and lastly surgery. Behavioral therapy is the first line of treatment, though it may be not acceptable for the patient, but this should try before giving drugs, or you can combine them. This is mainly limiting the bladder irritants like caffeine and alcohol. Limit the intake of caffeine and alcohol. Bladder training, urgency and suppression test, pelvic floor muscle exercise. This causes suppression of urgency. What is bladder training? Timed voiding. You ask the patient to void every half an hour in the initial stage. And try not to void in between. And slowly increase the time interval so that the patient gets a control over the bladder. But this may take months. But short term results are very good. And it is very good in young patients. Contraction of pelvic floor muscles by contracting the anal sphincter, you can suppress the urgency. So this regular practice is required, and the proper technique should be there. They should be correctly told how to contract the anal sphincter. This may require the help of physiotherapist. Drugs, the mainstay is anticholinergics, because parasympathetic supply is the one which makes the contraction of the bladder. We give anticholinergic drugs which inhibits the action of acetylcholine. So it prevents abnormal detrusor contraction. There are many drugs. Oxybutynin is one thing. Usually it is the first drug which came for this treatment, and it is given in 25 milligrams. But the main problem is it has more action on the salivary glands than on the bladder. So you get a dry mouth, which is very troublesome side effect. Dalterone is the another one, but this has less action on the salivary gland. So this is much preferred. And extended release tablets are much better than straight away absorbable tablets. So these are given in as a single dose, and the action is for 24 hours. The another one is mesotolvadrin, 8 milligram. This was found, now it is a newer anticholinergic. This has found to be very effective, and 8 milligram is very effective. But again, the problem of side effects, constipation. Drug interaction, these drugs interact with cytochrome P3A4 inhibitors like clarithromycin, ketoconazole, antidepressant. Many of these patients may be on antidepressant. So this anticholinergic should not be given along with these drugs, because their action will be prolonged. Again, lot of anticholinergics like solifenacin, diflunisal are there. Solifenacin is effective at 10 milligram dose. Diflunisal acts specifically on M3 receptors in the bladder. So it is better for elderly people. It is not having any cognitive function effect. So old people, it can be used, and the usual dose is 7.5 milligram. So, but these drugs have got a lot of side effects. Main thing is dry mouth and constipation. These are the, and sometimes blurred vision and drowsiness, confusion in elderly patients. Restorative can precipitate retention of urine, especially if the patient has mild obstruction due to prostate. These drugs can precipitate retention. So always you should rule out obstruction, or if there is obstruction or prostatic enlargement, give some drugs for prostatic enlargement also. Diphenhydramine causes side effect of headache. Solifenhydramine is again causing some UTI. These are all contraindicated in narrow angle glaucoma. Other drugs are beta agonists. Sympathetic system relaxes the bladder. So beta agonists can be given. This is usually mirabegron is given at 25 mg or 20 mg. Combined therapy, both solifenhydramine and mirabegron can be given. If it is 10 mg of solifenhydramine, 25 mg of mirabegron. If it is 5 mg of solifenhydramine, you have to give 20 mg of mirabegron. These are surgical therapy. I will just go through fast. Botulinum toxin injection, sacral neuromodulation, percutaneous tibial nerve stimulation. In severe symptoms, we have to do drastic measures like augmentation, cystoplasty, urinary diversion. But these are all mainly in neurogenic bladder where the overactivity is very severe. So we have got anticholinergics, beta agonists. They have got side effects which should be used carefully. And narrow angle glaucoma is a contraindication for anticholinergics. Thank you. Very much affecting the blood pressure also. It is a very safe drug. It is now being used instead of anticholinergics.
What is the role of old drug, Betanacol, in this situation?
Betanacol is actually a contraction. It contracts the bladder. It is used in hypertonic bladders.
Sir, what drug
it
is,
sir? They have got 25 mg and 50 mg. Spastic bladder is due to some pathological condition also. You have got a contracted bladder. It occurs in tuberculosis. Tuberculosis, you get a small, pimple bladder. There may be some pathological reasons. And a neurogenic bladder, they have got more pressure resisting, overactivity of the retrosphere. Overactive bladder is without neurogenic component.
What is the relation between narrow angle glaucoma and overactive bladder?
No, it is an anticholinergic, so it contracts the ciliary muscle. So the pressure in the eye will go. It's a narrow angle glaucoma, so it aggravates the condition. So you will have more pressure in the eye. That will deteriorate your vision. It is like atropine. You don't put atropine on that eye for dilatation and other things.
can I request a doctor?